Good morning, Faith family. Good morning. It is a beautiful Sunday morning, bright and early at 9:05 a.m. We are glad. We are glad you made it to the corner of 8th and Madison. As you're wrapping up those conversations, I would just invite you to stand with me this morning. I want to read a passage of scripture from Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, verse 4. It says, on one occasion, while he, Jesus, was eating with them, he gave them this command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Later on in that passage, he says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And I am growing more and more convinced that God really does like to show up where God is invited to show up. And I'm getting more convinced that God is not really competing for our attention. He's waiting for us to turn our attention. And so this morning, maybe we could start our time together just with a simple invitation for the Holy Spirit to come. Maybe you've heard this song before, but join with me this morning as we invite the Holy Spirit in this place today.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Oh, and fill the atmosphere. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare your living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Oh, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Yeah. Atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow in this place, fill Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow. Overflow in this place. Fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us. Oh, overflow in this place. Fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. Oh, you're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us. Spirit of God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be done here as in heaven. Fresh on us, we need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be done here as in heaven. Miracle can happen now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord sing overflow. Overflow in this place, fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us. The same God we can call on today is the same God that we read about in the Bible. Same God of Jacob, the same God of Mary, the same God of David, the God who parted the seas when they were at flood stage, the God who parted the seas and made a way. Does anybody in this space need Jesus to move in their lives? Does anybody in this space need a miracle or need the power of heaven to come down in your lives? Need healing? We have a way-making, miracle-working God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Sometimes I find it's easy to forget. He can do it today. What he did yesterday, he can do it again. So let's call on him today. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me.
you.
Father, we come to you this morning. We thank you, God, that you are alive. We thank you, God, that the tomb is still empty, that the rock is still rolled away, that you are still showing up, showing out, filling empty souls with your life-giving presence. Lord, we need a fresh touch of the living God today. More than a worship service, more than a sermon, more than a time to gather on a Sunday morning, we need the fresh encounter of the Holy Spirit of God. We thank you, Lord, that you love to come to where you're invited. So, Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place. Corporately, in our gathering together, we invite you into this community. Lord, and we all got our own things that we're carrying today. I've talked with people about housing needs and financial needs and job needs just this morning. So I know we're all carrying our own stuff. We got kid needs, relationship needs, all sorts of things are going on in this community right now that we've gathered in here to cast our gaze upon the one who can truly do something about the deepest needs of the human soul. And so, Lord, we're coming to the throne of grace today. Thank you for drawing us into this place. And, Lord, thank you for those who responded to be here in this place today. We're coming to find grace and mercy to help in our time of need. We're desperate for a move of God. We are hungry for the fresh touch of heaven in our lives. Oh God, awaken us today. Arise us today. And let Christ give us light and life today. God, we bless you and we love you. Thank you for who you are, for what you're doing. and for what you're about to do. Let miracles take place in the room today because of the faith that is in here. God, we bless you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Amen. Faith family, you may be seated. As you're being seated, would it be okay if you just kind of turned somebody beside you and said hello? Or maybe you use those neck muscles and turn around to somebody behind you and give them a little welcome here this morning. High five, a handshake, some knuckles. Just let them know they're welcome here today. As part of our worship this morning, we will be receiving this morning's tithes and offering, our giving. And so I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward, if you would. And I want to give just a prayer over our offering this morning. And so, Jesus, bless this offering today. Lord, bless the giver and the gift. May it be used here in this church to expand the kingdom of God, to preach the gospel to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, and to proclaim liberty to those who've been held captive by sin and Satan all their lives. May your kingdom come. May your will be done through this offering in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen. As they're receiving this morning's offerings, just a couple things I want to draw your attention to before we do a double backflip into the Word of God with Pastor Mark. You did come to do a double backflip into the Word of God to let it get deep into the soul, and so we're going to do that. So no pressure, but we're doing a double backflip today. Just a couple things in your worship folders I would love to just draw your attention to. The first is we are hosting a worship and prayer night called Pressing In. All the details are in the worship folder, but we want to seek the heart of God and allow the Spirit of God to do some breakthrough and some healing in our lives. And so just want to invite you to that. Again, the details are in the worship folder. Also, super excited about having one of our very own, Kelly Rush. She is going to be facilitating some healing prayer specifically for women. And again, the details for that are in the worship folder. You can look at that. You can call, text, schedule an appointment. If you'd like more information, the QR code for you to do that is in the worship folder. And last but not least, we will be receiving a pastor appreciation, staff appreciation, love offering here in a couple weeks. And the board secretary has wrote a little letter, and that too is in your worship folder. So all those things are in there. Take a look at them. You'll be glad you did. I just believe it will. Without any further ado, we're going to get into the Word of God. And we have Pastor Mark, our small groups and senior adult pastor, going to be bringing the Word this morning. So can we say thank you to Mark as he brings the Word today?
Thank you, brother. Ah, wonderful church family. So good to be with you and look at and see faces that have been such an impact on my life. Say, before we really get in the sermon, I just need to say this is an important anniversary for me. It was a year ago I was reunified with my wife. We'd been separated, not by marital strife, but by political strife. A year ago, I'd gone with 20 of my really good friends, and we'd gone for 2 weeks in the Holy Land, and we're going to spend half the time in Palestine, half the time in Israel, and we're going to see all the sights, and we're going to walk where Jesus walked. And the second morning that we were there, we woke up, and we heard a strange noise in the distance. And we come to find out that war had broke out between Hamas and Israel. I have my notes, which Jan's previewed all this. I'll make sure that Jan keeps me honest. Because, you know, preachers, we like to kind of stretch the truth a little. Well, not Pastor Ryan, of course. But. And so when she looked at this, she said, "Mom, Mark, you say about bombs going overhead." She said, "That didn't happen." I go, "Oh, well, I haven't told you that part yet." And I got pictures of bombs going off over our head. And so we were there. There were 20 of us. And we're wondering what to do. And for the most part, we've invested a lot of money. This is a lifetime bucket list type thing. We're already there. We don't see any fire in the street in front of us. And we thought, we can just go ahead and soldier on and find things to do and go to all the places and walk where Jesus walked, you know. But I got on the phone to Jan, and it was a very different story. Jan saw all the news articles, and which were all true, by the way, and she was nervous and she was anxious. And I could tell the first night that she wanted me to come home. And I thought, well, you know, after a day or so, things will quiet down. It'll be just a short-term thing. And both Jan and I will feel better, and we'll just pioneer on. And so I called her the second night, and I was about 5 minutes in that conversation. I go, no, Jan needs me to come home. So I just asked her, do you want me to come home? Yes. Does it make any difference how much it costs? No. So how could I enjoy floating in the Dead Sea, knowing that my wife was at home, wondering if I'd ever come home alive? I just couldn't do it. Maybe it would have been okay for you, but I just couldn't do it. So she found a good ticket for me. I did some really strange things. I didn't know how to get to an airport because now it was all on my own. The tour was going to pioneer on and continue acting like the war wasn't happening. So I had to kind of find my own way and pioneer my own way, but I did. And a year ago today, October 13th, we were reunified at the Eugene Airport. And I can tell you, that was a grand homecoming. If you've never woke up and had breakfast with bombs going off over your head, you don't know the joy and the relief of being back home, giving a hug to your wife. So, now, I have my notes that doesn't have anything to do with the sermon, but actually, that is the sermon. But by the way, we're in a sermon series called The Fight. Called The Fight. And it's going through the book of Ephesians, because the book of Ephesians ends up with the Apostle Paul, the guy who wrote it, saying, I want you to know all this that I've written so far is to give you the tools that you need to engage in the fight. We're in a fight. It's an invisible fight, but it's just as real as the bombs in the Middle East. It's just as real. There's just as much at stake. There's just as much fervor from the other side. There are forces of darkness, Paul says, forces of darkness, determined to divide groups and destroy people. Can you believe that? Yeah. That there are forces of darkness trying to divide people, divide groups and destroy people? I can believe it. There are spiritual powers, Paul goes on to say, whose only goal is your discouragement. Whose only goal is your discouragement. And the only way to avoid division, destruction, and discouragement is to wage war with spiritual weapons. Amen. Well, last week, Pastor Ryan said that what God expects of us is so lofty. His standards are so high, there's no way we could do it. And anyway, the devil's schemes are too clever that even if we had the strength, we don't have the smarts. Because the devil's schemes are too clever. But at the end, he said, what is impossible in our own efforts becomes immediately possible as soon as we surrender control of our life to God. And he called it changing positions. Changing positions. Changing positions from being in control of my life and the chief factor of how things go to allowing the Holy Spirit to take control. There is a spiritual battle raging around us, but also a spiritual battle raging within us. And it's a battle that's impossible to win. But when the battle becomes the Lord's, victory is ensured. So that's where we've been. And today we're going to examine one specific impossibility, marriage. It's impossible. I mean, I won't go into details about men being different than women, but if you've ever been on Facebook, you know that there's a lot of differences. And that wouldn't be the only way you'd find out, but it's one way. Jan and I have a great marriage. A great marriage. Outside of Jesus, Jan's the best thing that happened to me, and I don't even know what number three is. I'm just saying, she's in a category up there right next to Jesus, and I don't mind saying that. I don't know what it means about my theology. Jesus is first, but Jan is a very close second. But we don't have a perfect marriage. A couple examples. I struggle with anxiety. Nice way of saying it. I have times when, in fact, if I'm not anxious, I'm worried. Okay, now some of you know what I mean, and the rest of you are laughing at me. But that's okay. That's okay. If I don't know what to be anxious about, I'm worried that it's got to be so bad that when I find out, it's going to blow me away. And when I get anxious, the only way to kind of make life work for me is I need to control things. I need to really cinch down and control things. And somehow Jan still hasn't found out why my anxiety means I should control her. So our marriage isn't exactly perfect. I like to fix problems, which is a really good thing because Jan likes to tell me her problems. Okay, think about that. Yeah. What I found out along the way is that Jan doesn't tell me her problems because she wants me to fix them. She tells me her problems because she wants me to listen. Yes. You know, there's something in me that I can't respond to hearing a problem outside of solving it. I'm a problem fixer. And so it's not a perfect marriage. And I'm preaching out of a personal need. But I'm also preaching with great hope. Like you, I need to have a better marriage. I need to be a better husband is the way to really say it. And I'm not going to describe a perfect marriage today. My goal is to give you a hope you can have a better marriage. Is that okay? Is that not lowering things too much? It's biblical, by the way. We're going to look at that in just a minute. But I'm not here to describe and give you a picture. This is the perfect marriage and send you away defeated and discouraged. I want to send you away filled with hope. There's some things that you can do, and you can do them today, that's going to start to make you a better marriage partner and therefore your marriage a better place for the Holy Spirit to be at work. So here's where we read our passage, Ephesians 5, 18 to 33. You can read along with me if you want to. It'll be on the screen as well. It's a long passage, and we'll go through it once, and then we'll break it down into some little chunks. Verse 18, we're picking up a little bit at the end of last week's sermon. Ephesians 5:18, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing and making music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands, as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any kind of blemish, but holy and blameless. In this way, husbands ought to love their wives, well, as their own bodies, because he who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for it. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. The word of the God, the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Well, there's a lot there. In fact, at one point toward the end, Paul says, oh, wait a minute. I think I got confused. I ended up talking more about the church than about the marriage. And so we're going to break it down into short little sections. And I want to pull out what I think is the main flow of what's going on here. The primary command is in verse 18. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. That's the command. It's in a special tense in the Greek that says, here's something you have to do. Now, afterwards, there's going to be a lot of stuff, but there isn't going to be any commands until we get to the very end. So this is the command, and everything that follows is just commentary. It's just commentary on how we fill the command. In fact, in some ways, all the way to the end of the book, it's dependent upon, here's the primary command. Primary command is be filled with the Spirit. Pastor Ryan called this the change of positions. Being filled with the Spirit, it's just a nice kind of advertising talk for surrender control of your life to the Holy Spirit. Get out of the way and let God do his work.
Yes.
And so for us, what that means is that this morning, everything that follows are not so much principles that we need to apply in our own effort, but rather they're promises which we can receive. The promises from God that we can receive. And it's really easy to look at this and we get into men do this and women do that and think, well, these are principles that I apply on my own effort. I'm just going to go out and do them because God told me I had to. It changes radically when we take it to say, all we have to do is be filled with the Spirit, and then we receive these from the Holy Spirit. Well, then it goes on, the next little section, or evidences. If you're Spirit-filled, what will your life look like? Well, you'll be speaking to one another. Speaking to one another with words filled with grace, not degrading words.
Yes.
Okay? Words filled with grace, not degrading words. And it lists what those are, some categories. Singing and making music in your heart, not only does being filled with the Spirit change your vocabulary, it changes your emotions. Were your emotions affected this morning by the singing?
Yeah.
One person. Wow, my emotions were affected. I was swept. I was carried away. I was overwhelmed by that incredible worship set that our team did, which led us into God's presence, but also led God's presence into us.
Yes.
It changed my emotions. Giving thanks. When we're filled with the Spirit, it changes our attitudes. Rather than being grumbling, rather than being, I don't have this, rather than being glass almost empty, we thank God for all that he does for us. And then submitting to one another. These are all together. It's all one section in the way that the Greek is laid out. We're submitting to one another. It is one of the evidences of the Holy Spirit working in us. It affects our relationships so that I'm committed to doing what's best for you, and you're committed to doing what's best for me. Which sounds good, but all of us say, wait a minute. How can we be submitting to one another in the marriage or at work or with our kids, you know, when someone needs to take the lead and someone needs to follow? How can I submit to you and you submit to me at the same time? And so Paul, knowing that that's kind of a confusing thing, he gets downright nitty-gritty, and for the next three sections in this book, he says, here's what it means for the husband and the wife to submit to each other. The church submits to Christ, wives submit to their husbands and everything. Husbands, they submit by loving their wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. sacrificial love. And now I'm going to take one verse that's not on the chart. Verse 33. And you'll see why in just a minute. But I'm going to suggest that verse 33, Paul, after all Paul's written about husbands and wives and the church and so on, he sums it up and he kind of boils it down to just one verse with this way. Each man must love his wife as he loves himself. So the man's responsibility is love, and the wife must respect her husband. The submission that the man gives is loving. The submission that the wife gives is respecting. The next section I'm going to talk about comes right out of the Bible, but I got a lot of some concrete ideas from a book called Love and Respect. And it's a Christian man who's also a psychologist. Fortunately, those exist. And he's done a really nice job. And the title of his book is this, Love and Respect. Okay, right out of the text. Love and Respect. The love she most desires and the respect he desperately needs. On Amazon, it's the number 15 book on marriage. It's 13, 14 years old. It sold 1.6 million copies. So it's a popular book, and it has impacted literally millions, revolutionized millions of marriages. And so looking at verse 33, the primary way that the wife submits is by respecting her husband. The author, Emerson Eggerich, quotes a poll in his book, a poll of 400 men across the country, and they were asked this either-or question. Which would you rather be? Which would you rather be? Would you rather be left alone and unloved, or would you rather be feel inadequate and disrespected? So unloved or disrespected. 74% of the men said they'd rather be unloved than disrespected. Okay, so what Paul is saying and what the Holy Spirit says and what's been said in our scripture for 2,000 years lines up perfectly with modern research on what the deepest need of men is, and that is respect. Now, I know a lot of you are saying, I thought you were going to tell women that they had to obey their husbands. And that's there in the passage. But have you ever thought about how easy it is to obey someone and not respect them?
Oh, yeah.
Most of you find that really easy to do. A lot of us do it at work. Not me, of course. But I've had work that I've done where I obeyed everything the boss said, because that's the only way I get paid at the end of the week, and that's what I was in it for. I obeyed everything the boss said, but I definitely didn't respect him or one time her. In fact, whenever we got together as employees, we didn't talk with how much respect we had for our boss. We told all the stories and we embellished them about how foolish they were and how they didn't know how to run a business, you know, and how if they didn't have help in the morning, they couldn't tie their own shoes. You can obey a leader and not respect them. I think there's a lot of Christian wives, and I'm just going to say it. I think there's a lot of Christian wives who have been kind of focused on, I have to obey my husband no matter what, but there's not much respect. And the husbands catch on to that, women, just as much as women catch on to not being loved. I hear all the things that women say, you know, I'm in one room and I kind of hear what's going on in the next room. The one like, well, I've got two little ones, but I've got three kids to raise. Okay? That's not a sign of respect, just in case you were wondering. And there's a lot of other ways, too, which women have been, I think, so focused. I'm going to be a good Christian woman. I'm going to do what my husband says. But then anytime I get, I kind of seethe, and I get together with my women friends, and together we disrespect the husbands that God has given to us. We know all about unconditional love, agape love, which is, we'll get to men, and we're going to tie a bead on the men as well, by the way. But there's unconditional love that goes to the husband and goes to all Christians, really, all people. But unconditional respect. Verse 24 says that you should submit to your husband the same way you submit to Christ. Okay? You should submit to your husband the same way you submit to Christ. So do you tell Jesus, Jesus, I really love you, but I don't respect you? Is that the way that you follow Christ? Do you say, in your mind, I'm going to do everything that God says, but God's pretty stupid, you know? God's pretty foolish. God doesn't really know what he's doing. You know, I'm going to do this because I don't want to go to hell. But, you know, God could learn a few things from TikTok. No, you don't do that. You don't do that. I know you don't do that. In the same way that you respect God, your relationship with God is reminding God and reminding others how grateful you are to him. That you extol the greatness, that you magnify the glory of the Lord. Those same things, the Bible says, should apply to how you relate to your husband. God has placed a man in your life. Oh, by the way, if you're married, this is for you. If you want to be married someday, this is for you. If you're never, ever going to be married, this is for you, because this talks about how we help each other nurture and we grow as small groups, as friends, as teams. When God placed a man in your life, wives, he gave you a person that you understand that man. You know him better than anybody else. And if a man knows that the woman that knows him better than anyone else doesn't respect him, there isn't any other way his need for respect is going to be met, because the hole is plain too deep. How do you respect your husband? Sometimes it's harder than others. I'll just be honest. I know it is. But it begins by going back to the Psalm 139 I preached on a long time ago. It seems like now. It says that every person, God made them fearfully and wonderfully. Yes. So one of the ways that your prayer time can be filled with, if you're having a hard time respecting your husband, is to say, God, how did you fearfully and wonderfully make my husband? What special gifts, what special insights, what special talents did he give? And I want to hear what those are from you, God, and then I'm going to tell my husband, and I'm going to start filling that need that he has to be a person of respect. If you can't find anything in your husband to respect, then that's the signal, that's the red flag, that's the button going off, that you need to get back to the primary command. The primary command is what?
Be filled with the Spirit.
Be filled with the Spirit. And so if you're having a struggle giving respect to your husband, it's not a problem with your husband. Oh, might be a little problem with your husband. It's not so much a problem with you, a little bit, but the big thing is you need to get back to the Holy Spirit, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and say, Holy Spirit, help me respect my husband. Give me something to share. Give me something to hang on. What are the things that my husband is? What are the things that he does that deserve respect? Jan's my number one cheerleader. It's, I know she loves me. Wow. All the things she does every day that she loves me. But I also know that she admires me. I know that she tells others. I know that because I remember one time Jen's worked for 5 years among the leadership at Lincoln County government. And the first time I went to see her, I was introduced to all these big people and big responsibilities, super important people. And they all said, oh, so you're the person that Jan's always bragging about. There was something that happened to me that was good. They also told me what a wonderful person Jan was. And I go, well, yeah, I've known that for a while. One thing you can do is you can show respect and give respect and articulate respect for your husband's work ethic. God made men to receive their sense of self-worth from the work that they do. One of the very first things that God told Adam was tend the garden. Even before sin, there was work to do. Don't know exactly what it was, but that's okay. The fact is, God made men to have a task and to work to accomplish that task. He made us to solve the problems that we see around life. Have you told your husband how much you respect and admire and how much strength you get from their desire to be a hard worker? Jan told me one time about this YouTube thing that she'd seen, and she was really excited about it. And I'm sorry, Jan, I was a little bit bored. But she told me the story, and it was a camera that was a video camera that was put on the front door of an apartment, I think in somewhere in London, and it showed 900 days. Of course, going fairly fast, but 900 days. Every day at exactly the same time, the husband came out of that home, and he left, and he went a certain way. And every night at exactly the same time, he came back and came home. And she told me this, and she told it in great detail, and I'm sitting there trying to act interested. And then she said, "Mark, that reminded me of you. You're that man." And wow, that hit me. She was saying that she respected my faithfulness in taking care of my family financially and coming home every night. That she could count on me, that she did count on me, and there wasn't any reason for her not to count on me. And I can tell you, I felt like Superman for a week. And there wasn't anything I wouldn't have done for Jan. In fact, there isn't anything I still wouldn't do for Jan. She respected my work ethic. Respect his insight. Thank him for his advice. I know it's a problem with men wanting to always fix problems. But the fact is, men do always want to fix problems. And once in a while, our ideas are pretty good. When your husband applies logic and a certain kind of method to tackling the family problem, because we don't have much intuition, so what we're left with is logic and method. When he does that to tackle a family problem, thank him and follow him. Say, "I'm so glad that you're invested in what's going on in our family to think of a way to handle the problem." Show respect for his leadership in the family. What would happen if this week you were to text your husband while he's at work and say, "I'm so blessed to have a husband that takes care of our family finances"? I think he'd be home a little bit quicker than usual. You know, just send him a text. He needs to get milk, sure. But send him a text saying, "This is what I appreciate about you this week. As I was praying, I was just overcome with the fact that as my husband, you fill in the blank, whatever the level of respect is, whatever the item of respect is." Your husband needs you at this level, and as you do that, that will liberate the man to be what he's called to be, the husband, which is a loving leader. The husband submits to his wife by loving his wife. It's all the way through this passage. In fact, I think it's about the only thing that's told to the husband with some commentary and explanation. It's in the end, verse 33, each man must love his wife, but it's also in verse 25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up, sacrificial love. Verse 28, in the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they do their own bodies. It's interesting, in contrast, at the time that this letter is written, the Roman society and the Greek society, the wise people in those societies were writing lots of things to couples because this thing of being married has always been impossible. And the people who are really hungry to do well at it are always open to a good suggestion. And so there's always been people who could sell a book or a video or a YouTube or whatever else by saying, here's how to have a better marriage. And so in the Greek culture, in the Roman culture, all those instructions led with men, here's how to rule your woman. That's not my words. I'm saying 2,000 years ago, here's how to control your wife. And there are detailed instructions with all the tricks you could do to make sure that you had control over your wife. Paul leads, the Holy Spirit leads, our Bible says love. We lead, but we lead by loving. We're to be like Jesus, who sacrificed everything to meet our deepest needs. That's exactly what we're told in this passage. That's boiling down about 8 verses into one little sentence. We lead our marriages by sacrificing everything to meet our deepest need. I remember Jan's mom came one time to visit us when we were just newly married, and I was in the bedroom getting dressed for the day. Jan and her mom were out in the living room just visiting, and I could hear every word they said because it was a really small house with almost no walls, paper-thin walls. And Jan's mom was kind of getting on Jan's case and with these words, you tell me there's not enough money in your family budget for the groceries, but there's enough money for Mark to have 2 razors. I knew at that time that I needed to make progress on making Jan's needs the priority in my life. And you can talk to her afterwards and see if I've made any progress. Hopefully I'm doing better than that. That's my goal. Okay, hit the wrong button on my iPad. Husbands, love your wives sacrificially. Here we are. Which means loving your wife means letting her know she's the most important thing in your life. You tell her, you're the most important thing in my life. You tell other people, she's the most important thing in your life. I've tried to model that this morning. But more than the talk, it's the walk. Yes. It's consistently choosing her desires over your own preferences. And Pastor Daniel told a story to me this week that perfectly illustrates this. I thought, wow, I couldn't think of a better illustration. Hopefully it's true. I mean, it's so perfect, you kind of wonder. Like I say, if I'm not anxious, I'm worried. But both Daniel and Emma gave me the freedom to share this. One morning this week, Daniel's looking around at his apartment. They're getting ready to move from one apartment in their complex to another apartment in this same complex. And he's looking around at the house, and he says, why isn't all of our stuff in boxes? When Emma gets home, I should tell her that she needs to get things boxed up. And then quickly, the better thought came to him, wait a minute, if this is important to me, I'm here now and she's working. She's pregnant and I'm not. Maybe I ought to be the one that does the boxing. Okay, good decision? Wait, we haven't got to the punchline. That's only the beginning. This just gets better. And so then he asked the miracle question, which men we ought to be asking all the time. He asked, how would Emma box up the house? Whoa. Men, I think you just heard the wives say, and the way he told me the story, I won't use the exact word, but what he used was more or less, he says, the strange thing is Emma would clean up the house thoroughly first. He says, I don't know why, but I knew that if I was going to do this the way that Emma would, I would spend the day cleaning up the house, and then I'd start the boxing. So that's what he did. Another round of applause. That's taking leadership. That's loving. That's loving your wife sacrificially. Loving your wife means living with her. I was talking to some college students one time and talking about marriage relationships, and it was all guys in this particular group, and they're all nodding their heads like, oh yeah, I do that, I do that. I'm really good at that. My wife needs to be hearing that. And then I got to the part where it says living with your wives. And I looked them all in the face and I said, are you living with your wife? And the automatic thing was, I said, does your wife know that you're living with her? And all of a sudden, a sense of guilt went, because these were guys that didn't spend any time with their wives. They were good Christian men. They were going to school, a lot of them time invested. They were providing, but they didn't, it was not important for them to actually live with their wives. That means that you spend time with them, and that when you spend time with them, they know you're spending time with them. How are we doing on time, by the way? Oh, yeah, we get to wrap up now. Spending time with her means you listen to her with your cell phone turned off. I was challenged one time at a marriage conference, another quick illustration, challenged at a marriage conference to come home from work, to sit down and to tell Jan three things that had happened at work that day. That was probably the hardest assignment I've ever had. Because when I come home, I just want to sit down and veg out for a little bit. And there isn't anything that happens at my work that's worth talking about. And so that first week, it was so awkward, guys. It was so awkward and so un-me, so hard to do. And I struggled to find three things. Second week, it got a little bit better. And I can tell you now, it's one of the best times of my day is I come home and I connect with Jan. I'm not just working for her, but I'm living with her. And of course, when I tell Jan three things that happened to me, then she tells me three things that happened to her, and we're having a conversation that goes for who knows how long. Love your wives. Improving your marriage requires spiritual warfare. Remember, it's the fight. For instance, you're probably saying right now, you know, I just don't really feel like doing this. I don't feel respectful. I don't feel like giving love. But this is not a check on your emotions. It's a check on your trust in the Holy Spirit. A check on your trust in the Holy Spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit to give your guidance and then act upon that guidance. Because when we ask the Holy Spirit to lead us, the Holy Spirit will lead us. And then the question is, am I going to follow? And along the way, watch your emotions gradually change. It's a spiritual warfare thing. And sometimes it comes out this way. What if I were to start loving my wife and she didn't respect me in return right away? Can I really take the risk of taking being the first one and taking the initiative? Well, this is warfare. Sometimes in warfare, we have to take the hit. Sometimes in warfare, we have to endure the pain. Warfare, this is a long-term battle. We have to practice long obedience and give God time to do his work. Yes. So it's time for the challenge. Time for the challenge. Worship team, you can come up if you want. I'm not going to ask you to come forward this morning and pray. Now, I won't stop you. And if you want to come up after the sermon and talk to me and have me pray for you, I'd be delighted to. That's not what I'm asking. I'm asking you to make two vows. I'm asking you to make two vows. The first vow is this, that you're going to start receiving from God respect for your husband or love for your wife. A vow that you're going to receive God's ability. Is that something you can do? To receive? Is that something you could do? Can you change positions so that you're not the one that's required to find a way to make the principle work? All you're to do is receive from God the leadership. Is it something you can do right now? So that's the first vow. The first vow is, I'm going to receive God's ability to love my wife more and to respect my husband more. And then the second vow, having done that, the second vow is, I'm going to tell my spouse this afternoon that I'm responding to God's call to be a better spouse. I don't know how that conversation will go, how long. It might be really short, might be really long, but that's two vows I'm asking you to make. Is, I'm going to start receiving God's grace and God's leadership and God's guidance to be a better spouse. Love the wife, respect the husband, and this afternoon, I'm going to share with my spouse that I'm starting to receive God's grace for being a better spouse. Let's pray. God, I sense that there's people in this room that have made that vow, and they said, yes, I can do that. I don't know exactly all that it means. I've got a little bit of a hint, but I know that if I go to the Holy Spirit and I'm filled with God's goodness and God's grace and God's truth, that I'm going to be a better spouse. I'm going to be able to love my wife better. I'm going to be able to give deeper and more meaningful respect to my husband. And God, I'm going to do that. And oh, Lord Jesus, I'm afraid, but I'm also excited that this afternoon I'm going to say, you know, having listened to that message this morning and having listened to the Holy Spirit, I just want you to know I've made a vow to start receiving from God all that I need to be a better spouse to you. God, flood our lives, just the way our early song said, flood our lives and let it flow over in love and respect to each other in such a way that brings you glory, strengthens our marriages, heals those that are hurting, inspires those that are healthy to be all we were called to be. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Stand with me, let's sing.
Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing. Oh, promises, all your promises are yes and amen. So I will rest in your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest, I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest, I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest, I'm gonna rest in your promises. My confidence, it's in your faithfulness. Oh, faithful you are, faithful forever you will be. All your promises are yes and amen. Sing faithful, faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Yeah, faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises, all your promises are yes and amen. Oh, all your promises are yes and amen.
Can we say thank you to Pastor Mark one more time for bringing a word to us today? It's certainly not the easiest passage of Scripture to teach through, but I do believe that the enemy is seeking to deteriorate and destroy marriage relationships, because the marriage relationship is a living testimony, a walking picture of the relationship between Christ and the church. And so I pray God's richest blessings over your marriages today. May the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord so fill you that it displaces your own control of your life and the Holy Spirit begins to take the lead. And if you're not in a season where marriage is in your deck of cards, maybe later in life, maybe the passing of a loved one and you're not going to get remarried, or maybe teenagers is just not quite there yet. Paul was really talking about the church and Jesus. So may the Spirit of God so fully fill you, and may your relationship with Jesus be so wholly His that He fills you with joy and peace and love and life in the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, God bless you, Faith family. Thanks for being here. We got classes that are going on after service. You're more than welcome to attend those. But God bless you. We'll see you next Sunday.
Faithful you are, faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are, all your promises are yes and amen. Oh, all your promises are yes and amen. Faithful you are, faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are, all your promises are yes and amen. Promises are yes and amen.